Good afternoon, everyone. In this video, I'm going to talk about the other economic problem, which is the problem of unemployment in India. So unemployment, as we all know, is at present, especially, is at its all-time high. According to the latest data compiled by the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, the unemployment rate in India has increased to 7.2% in February 2019, which has been the highest rate since September 2016, and the rate of unemployment previously in the same time period in February 2018 used to be 5.9%. So there has been a considerable increase in the rate of unemployment. So what exactly unemployment is? Normally, it is defined as, or we can say that unemployment occurs when a person who is actively searching for employment is unable to find work. So it is the involuntary component of unemployment which is more specifically considered to be unemployment. That is, when people are looking for job, they are actively seeking for jobs, but they are unable to find work. And it is used as a measure of health of the economy. The more the number of unemployed people in the economy, the lesser or lower will be their living standards. They will not be able to earn income, earn money, and thus it affects savings in the economy, it affects investments in the economy, and therefore high unemployment levels, they indicate the bad health of the economy. And most of the times, the frequently used measure of unemployment is the unemployment rate, which is the number of unemployed people divided by the number of people in the labor force. According to the National Sample Survey Office, it defines unemployment and employment based on the activity status of the individual. So activity status can be of three types. First is, if the person is working, that means he is engaged in any economic activity, then that person would be considered employed. Second is, the person is seeking jobs, they are available to work, so they are considered to be unemployed. And then the third category is, when there is no activity taking place, that is, the person is neither seeking any job nor is available for work. So for calculating the unemployment rate, the first two constitute the labor force of the economy, that is, those who are employed as well as those who are unemployed. And if we add them and divide them by the total labor force, we obtain the unemployment rate in the economy. Now, when we talk of unemployment in India, it's of various types. Before that, it is important to understand the nature of unemployment in India. In India, the unemployment is prevalent in both urban and rural areas, where in urban areas, the main reason why unemployment arises is because of mismatches between the demand and supply of skill. So there is a skill gap, and thus there is industrial unemployment. And nowadays, a more peculiar problem of educated unemployed is also seen in urban areas, where most of the people belonging to middle class families, they have access to education, they read a lot, attain higher degrees, but still they are looking for jobs. They are not willing to work at low paying jobs. So that is a category of educated unemployed. And then in rural areas, most of the times, people are dependent on agriculture, on most of them are farmers, and especially small and marginal farmers are there in India. So their employment, that is the time they will be working and earning money, is a very short. Depending upon the season of the crop in which they are, the crop which they are growing and selling in the market. So there is seasonal unemployment, and then there is a problem of disguised unemployment. So there are both supply side factors as well as demand side factors which cause unemployment. That is a gap between the demand for labor and supply of labor. So talking about first of all, the most prevalent form of unemployment in India is disguised unemployment, a phenomena where more people are employed than actually needed. So there is a problem of surplus labor in a particular area. More people than actually required are working. So that is disguised unemployment, and it is traced primarily in the agricultural and unorganized sectors of India. And it is also a fact of worry that in Indian context, majority of the labor force is engaged in or is employed in the unorganized sector, which is a whopping 92%. Only 8% of the labor force is employed in the formal sector, protected by proper rules and regulations and availing all the social security benefits. But a large chunk of population is engaged in the unorganized sector, where they are not protected by any sort of rule or regulation, any labor law, and any social security benefit. Then, so in such areas, in the unorganized sectors and in the agricultural sector, disguised unemployment is a common scenario. That is, since people are not able to find jobs anywhere else, they're working on their fields only, but they may not be required to work there. Then there is seasonal unemployment, again, a form of rural unemployment. That is an unemployment which occur during certain seasons of the year. So when the season for which crop is not grown or it is not ready for harvesting, then that is the time period when people would be unemployed. And agricultural laborers in India rarely have work throughout the year. So it's not that they're working for 12 months in a year, they're working for only a few months. So they are said to be seasonally unemployed. Then there is structural unemployment, a category of unemployment arising from the mismatch between the jobs available in the market and the skills of the available workers in the market. So whenever there is a structural transition in the economy, the share of agriculture sector declines and that of industrial and service sector increases in the total GDP, then such type of unemployment arises because the skills of the workers, they tend to become outdated. And as industries advance, the service sector progresses, the employers find it hard to get skilled workers, and that is why unemployment arises. So, arising because of mismatch between jobs available in the market and the skills of the available workers in the market. And many people in India do not get job because of lack of requisite skills and due to poor education levels. And that is why it also becomes difficult to train them. Then there is cyclical unemployment. It results in the business, it is the result of business cycles where unemployment arises during recessions and declines with the economic growth. So when economy is going through a slowdown, that is a demand deficient, unemployment is there. There is less demand in the economy. There is lack of aggregate demand. Economy is in a slowdown, is suffering from recession. Then firms start firing the labor and unemployment increases. So that is termed as cyclical unemployment. And as economy starts recovering from that phase of recession, eventually as its growth takes place, as GDP grows, so does the levels of employment in the economy. In India, cyclical unemployment figures are negligible because we have not faced so much of recession or depression as other advanced countries have faced. It is a phenomenon which is found mostly in capitalist economies. Since Indian economy is a mixed economy, we rarely get through cyclical unemployment. Then another category is technological unemployment. That is when there are advances in technology, more automation of work takes place, so workers, they start losing jobs. The artificial intelligence is a prominent example of this. There is a controversy also regarding this area, that as more and more robots will be used for all the cores, then people will start losing their jobs. In 2016, World Bank data predicted that the proportion of jobs threatened by automation in India is 69% year on year. So that is another problem that we have to deal with. And then there is frictional unemployment, the most common form, that is unemployment which arises for a particular time period, and it is the time period where in which the people are looking for jobs, they're switching from one job to the other. So it is more of a voluntary unemployment. It is also called search unemployment. That means it refers to the lag between the jobs when an individual is searching for a new job or switching between the jobs. And when an employer requires the time for searching a new job or shifting from one job to the other, this inevitable time delay causes frictional unemployment. For that particular time period, that person would be unemployed. It is considered often as voluntary unemployment because it is not caused due to shortage of job. But in fact, the workers themselves quit their jobs in search of better opportunities. Then there is a very common form of unemployment that is prevailing in India currently is the vulnerable unemployment. That means most of the people are working. Though they are working, they are going to jobs every day, but there are no job contracts that they have signed on. So there are no records, there is no paper work which shows that they are actually working for a particular organization. So vulnerable unemployment means people working informally without proper job contracts, and thus they lack any legal protection. These persons are deemed unemployed since records of their work are never maintained, and it is one of the main types of unemployment in India. Now talking about how unemployment is measured in India. In India, the unemployment data is collected by the, most of the times it is collected by the National Sample Survey Office, and they have given the definition of unemployment, that how unemployment has to be measured in India. So they have given three approaches. First is the usual status approach. This approach estimates only those number of people, or only those people who are unemployed or had no gainful work for a major time during the 365 days preceding the date of survey. So when they have to conduct the survey to find out the number of people unemployed, they check for their activity status of the preceding 365 days to the date of survey. And if anyone who has been unemployed for 365 days, that is for a year, then that would be considered unemployed as per the usual status approach. Then the other approach is the weekly status approach. It records only those persons as unemployed who did not have any gainful work even for an hour or any day of the week preceding the date of survey. So if prior to a week of the survey date, if anyone is not working, has not done any sort of gainful work, even for 1 hour on any of the day during that week, that means the condition for a person to be called employed would be that for the entire 7 days or 6 days preceding the date of survey, he or she should be working. If anyone is unemployed, is not doing, has not done any sort of gainful work even for 1 hour on any day in that particular week, then that would be considered as unemployed. And then daily status approach is there. Under this approach, unemployment status of a person is measured for each day in a reference week. A person having no gainful work for even 1 hour in a day would be described as unemployed for that day. Now, there are some glaring unemployment statistics in India. As I told earlier, the rate of unemployment has increased. It increased to 7.2% in 2019. And then the total number of employed persons in February 2019 is estimated at 400 million against 406 million in the year ago period and 407.5 million employed in February 2017. So this trend shows that the unemployment, it has increased. The number of employed people were 407.5 million in 2017. It reduced to 406 in 18 and then to 400 in 2019. And as far as the labor participation is concerned, the labor participation rate, it also fell from 43.2% in January 2019 to 42.2% in February 2019. That is, within a span of 1 month, we witnessed a decline in the labor participation rate of up to 1%. So, where labor participation rate defines that section of working population in the economy which is currently employed or seeking employment. So, some data is there telling about the state of employment or unemployment in India. Now, why does this happen? What are the causes of unemployment? So, it may occur because of large population. Obviously, when population is beyond control, there is a lot of population in the country, then it becomes difficult to generate as much jobs to absorb the increased labor force. Then another cause in Indian context is the low or no educational levels and vocational skills of the working population. Most of the people, they suffer from structural unemployment because they lack the requisite skills, and nowadays it is not the unemployment which is the main issue, but it is the problem of unemployability of people. That is, people have access to educational attainment, they study a lot, they attain higher degrees, but still they do not know the basic concepts, or they lack the requisite skills. They are not trained as per the demand of the market, and thus they remain unemployed. That means even if they have all the qualifications for a particular job, that means the educational qualifications, but still they are not able to comprehend even the simple lines or simple data, and that is unemployability, which is the major problem, and thus nobody wants to hire people who are incompetent. And then another cause is inadequate state support. Governments are not supporting people. Legal complexities are there. Low infrastructural, financial and market linkages to small cottage industries, that is missing. Then that is why such enterprises, small industries, they become unviable. They do not have access to finance. There are no proper marketing market linkages for such industries. And in rural India, most of the workers, they are either employed in agriculture, or even if they are self-employed, they're working, they're producing or manufacturing at a very small scale. But such small or cottage industries have poor infrastructure. They have to get involved in a lot of legal complexities and so on. And that is why they become unviable. And thus, most of them do not last long, and thus enabling people to lose their jobs. Then there is another problem, that is huge workforce is associated with informal sector. They are not able to find work in the organized or the formal sector of the economy because they lack required education or skills, and thus they are not captured in any employment data. So there are a host of examples like domestic workers, domestic helpers, construction workers, etc. They are not covered under any labor law, or they are not sometimes counted in for the data of unemployment. Then another reason is that outdated syllabus being taught in schools and colleges, which is of course not as per the current requirements of industries, which leads to structural unemployment. Inadequate growth of infrastructure and low investments in manufacturing sector, thus restricting employment potential of secondary sector. Then in agricultural sector, there is low productivity combined with lack of alternative opportunities for agricultural workers, which makes transition from primary to secondary and tertiary sectors difficult. And another major reason why people are unemployed or the labor participation rate is too low in India is because of regressive social norms, which deter women from taking or counting and taking employment in the or continuing employment in the economy. Then talking about the impact of unemployment, it gives rise to the problem of poverty. That is the obvious consequence of unemployment. People are unemployed, they are not able to generate income for themselves and thus remain poor. Then young people, after a long time of unemployment, they indulge in illegal and wrong activities for earning money, so which increases the crime in the country. So it does not have only economic effects in the form of labor exploitation and industrial disputes, but it also has social effects in terms of making people indulge in illegal activities. Unemployed people can easily be enticed by antisocial elements. Thus, this makes them lose faith in democratic values of the country and they may shake the very political base of the country. Then it is often seen that unemployed people end up getting addicted to drugs and alcohol, or they attempt suicide, leading losses to human resources of country. And it also affects the economy. It has the economic effect also, that is the workforce that could have been gainfully employed to generate resources, it actually gets dependent on remaining working population, thus escalating socio-economic cost for the government. So for example, if 1% increase in unemployment reduces the GDP by 2%. So it is very important for governments also to maintain the growth rate, that is to promote or to make sure that the growth of the economy is not jobless. That is, if GDP is growing, there should be also increase in jobs, particularly in the industrial sector of the economy, so that further increases in the growth rate does not hamper or they are not obstructed. So it is important to also keep in mind the socio-economic costs of unemployment. Then a lot of steps have been taken by the government in order to get rid of this problem of unemployment or reduce unemployment in the Indian economy. So there are various programs as discussed earlier. There is IRDP, which was launched in 1980 to create full employment opportunities in rural areas. Then there was TRISEM, Training of Rural Youth for Self-Employment. The scheme was started in 1979 with the objective to help unemployed rural youth between the age of 18 and 35 years to acquire skills for self-employment. And in that, more priority was given to SC, ST youth and women. Then there was another scheme which was initiated or tried jointly by Shri Dharmasthal Manjunatheshwara Educational Trust, Syndicate Bank and Canara Bank in 1982. And they set up the Rural Development and Self-Employment Training Institute in Karnataka. There is a place in Dharmasthal, Karnataka, where they set up this institute. Now, such self-employment training institutes, RSETI stands for Rural Self-Employment Training Institutes, are now managed by banks. So they give them funding. They are managed by banks with cooperative, with active cooperation from the government of India and the state government. Then in, with effect from April 1, 1989, two main schemes which were prevalent through two employment programs which are prevalent, that is the NREP, National Rural Employment Program, and RLEGP, that is Rural Landless Employment Guarantee Program. They were merged into a single scheme known as the Jawahar Rozgar Yojana from 1989. So which is meant at solving the problem of rural unemployment. Then the most comprehensive action that has been taken so far by the Indian government is the implementation of MNREGA. So a scheme which was launched in 2005 to provide social security by guaranteeing a minimum 100 days of paid work per year to all the families whose adult members opt for unskilled labor intensive work. So this act has given a people the right to work. So it's a very important, prominent scheme run by the government of India. Then there is Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana under the Skill India initiative launched in 2015 to enable a large number of Indian youth to take up industry relevant skill training that will help them in securing a better livelihood. Then there is Startup India scheme, which was launched in 2016. Aiming at developing an ecosystem that promotes and nurtures entrepreneurship across the country. Then Stand Up India scheme, which was launched in 2016, aiming to facilitate bank loans between rupees 10 lakh and rupees 1 crore to at least one SC or ST borrower and at least one woman borrower per bank branch for setting up a greenfield enterprise. Then what is the way forward? How government can actually tackle this problem of unemployment, which is not only a social evil, it has not only just does it has economic repercussions but also social disadvantages. And so what actually government can do it about it? So there are a number of labor intensive manufacturing sectors in India. It is important to shift focus from capital intensive industries to labor intensive industries, and there are a lot of labor manufacturing sectors in India, like we have food processing industries, leather and footwear industry, wood manufacturers and furniture makers, textiles and apparels and garments and so on. So for such labor intensive units, special packages individually designed for each industries, they are needed to create jobs. Then public investment is also required in areas like health, education, police and judiciary so that government jobs can be created. Decentralization of industrial activities is necessary for people so that people of every region get employment. Then development of rural areas will also help mitigate the migration of rural people to urban areas, thus decreasing the pressure on urban area jobs. Entrepreneurs guarantee employments to many in a country. So government needs to encourage entrepreneurship among the youth. Also, concrete measures aimed at removing social barriers for women's entry and their continuation or their continuous participation in the job market is also needed. Governments need to keep a strict watch on the education system and should try to implement new ways to generate skilled labor force. Effective implementation of the current programs like Make in India, Skill India, Startup and Stand Up India is required. And moreover, there is a common consensus among policymakers for a need to set up or implement or initiate a national employment policy that would encompass a set of multidimensional interventions covering a whole range of social and economic issues affecting many policy spheres and not just the areas of labor and employment. So there must be a multidimensional educational program which covers various economic and social issues apart from labor and employment. So the policy would be critical tool to contribute significantly to achieve the goals of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. Now, what could such a policy include? It could include enhancing human capital through skill development, creating sufficient number of decent quality jobs for all citizens in the formal as well as informal sectors to absorb those who are available and willing to work, strengthening social cohesion and equity in the labor market, coherence and convergence in various initiatives taken by the government, supporting the private sector to become the major investor in productive enterprises, supporting self-employed people by strengthening their capabilities to improve their earnings, and ensuring employees' basic rights and developing an education, training and skill development system aligned with the changing requirements of labor market. So that is it for the video. In the next lecture, I will be talking about the problem of low capital formation in India. Thank you so much.